Yes, perfect. So thank you very much for actually organizing this event today. I think for many of us, it's the first time having a live event somewhere where to meet people face-to-face again. So congratulations to the organization here for getting that done. It's quite a tremendous effort, I think. So thank you very much for organizing that. But I will jump into the last question being presented to Fabien. So Fabien, I hope you're still listening in as well.
Yeah.
Because I want to talk a little bit about space first before jumping into what Hiber is all about. So from my background, I graduated in aerospace engineering back at the time, but moved to Harvard to really beef up my business skills and the financial one, and started my career in investment banking. So it started with a few of those investors actually looking into the space market and understanding that there are opportunities. At the same time, we saw companies like Planet coming up, as well as Spire. And I think by now it's a true definition. When you talk about Earth observation, you're talking about Planet. When you're talking about tracking vessels, or maybe even airplanes nowadays, you're talking about Spire. But there is really nothing there yet, except for huge constellations for broadband internet when it comes to IoT connectivity, or basically connectivity for just assets that want to give simple, and I usually say unintelligent, updates once in a while. So low bandwidth, low power is what it's all about. So I had the pleasure of actually being a neighbor of Robbie, one of the founders of Planet back at the time. He moved to Amsterdam, which is where I'm from. And together with them, we did quite some brainstorming. And therefore, your first question regarding should we build our own satellites, yes or no, is one I discussed with him as well. And that is quite interesting because we perceive the industry or community, because it's not that big yet, as mature enough to take care of customers like us to build our satellites. So what we have done at the very beginning is saying, okay, there are now a handful, maybe six, seven, that are capable of launching and building and developing these satellites for us. And unfortunately, from a maturity perspective and having control over your destiny as a company, that is today still not the case. So we first launched our first two satellites with third-party satellites, basically, co-developing, but with third parties in the lead. And we took that in-house nowadays. So that is something that I want to give as an example of what we experienced from Hiber first. So jumping into what is Hiber really, we provide ourselves as being the missing link for IoT applications. And therefore, we are able to connect anything anywhere. So whether it's monitoring or tracking your asset, we can do that, so even in your mom's backyard. It's a simple idea, extremely small and simple, but with a huge opportunity. And we founded the company about 4.5 years ago. We launched our first two satellites 2 years ago, and with various awards being won, I want to mention one quickly, is that we are now a national icon. The research group that developed Wi-Fi is led by a Dutch gentleman. The same can be contributed when it comes to Bluetooth. So the Dutch government actually sees, after Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, that hyperband is the next big thing when it comes to connectivity. Instead of using the rest of those 12 minutes remaining to actually explain Hiber, we made a video of 1 minute, so pay attention and let's go.
Are you seeing anything there right now?
So I'll jump into some of the aspects you just have seen in the video. But when we really started out as a company, we saw that there was no cost-effective global connectivity solution. Of course, there is GSM, Bluetooth, and also LoRa and Sigfox were coming up as a low-power wide area network. But then there's also a huge gap that is only filled by broadband satellites, such as Starlink or Inmarsat, but they are incredibly expensive, and there is no solution available today when it comes to the benefits that GSM has with the low power elements, as well as the global coverage. And therefore, most of these use cases are currently impossible to solve. Now, to get going, we actually launched our own network, and therefore we have two of those satellites in space nowadays. What we have developed is a low power modem. We developed our own antennas, and we have our own satellites in space, as well as our customer mission control and analytics, including ground stations on several locations around the world. We had to launch our own satellites because there simply was no other solution given the area we wanted to serve. However, just providing a modem and an antenna is not good enough to serve end customers. So, as an unproven technology very early on, we discussed with our customers to make sure we have market penetration. And to get that done, we basically bundled our sensors into a package solution and providing a full end-to-end solution towards these customers to drive early adoption and to show that our customers or our solutions truly work. So instead of just providing a modem that we developed or an antenna, we are providing end-to-end solutions to our customers to take ownership over the full constellation. So pretty proud, within 2 years after founding the company, we launched our first two satellites. And with those satellites, we have a commercial service ready anywhere in the world for once per day, reading out any kind of applications. However, and that is basically what this year is all about for almost every company, then Corona hit. And what has happened, one of these articles are in Dutch, the other one is coming from the European Space Agency. So on one hand, we were all ready to go with our customers, everything in the field, just press play. And then every company in the world, or at least our customers, needed to focus on business as usual. And therefore, these kinds of new innovative projects were put on hold. That's quite a struggle. Luckily, we raised enough money just prior to the pandemic, and therefore, we are in a very healthy situation at the moment. But in the meantime, we were building our next satellites by ourselves, and we needed to do a lot of testing to be in time for our next satellite launch. At that point in time, it was not known yet that the whole launch industry would have a huge impact, or would have huge impact by the launch services as well, basically shifting the launches 6 to 9 months. But we did all kinds of creative ways, including having ESA taking over our satellite and doing the testing themselves while wearing masks, et cetera, to just keep up with the schedule. So although most companies are actually having trouble in these times, which is of course very unfortunate, we are actually doing a great job. We have full confidence. We have hired about 15 to 20 new people during this pandemic as well, really showing that we are here for growth. So everything is ready from a technical but also commercial perspective of really moving to that next phase. And therefore, we started taking this time to really focus on those end-to-end solutions that we now have all in the field. As Fabian just explained, it takes quite some time to get the proper product market fit for the technical solution that you have available. And therefore, we say that it is a great opportunity to, at one end, have your own network, but at the same time, also make use of networks that are out there already. So we're trying to see whether we can be network agnostic and leverage the other constellations that are out there as well. I'm just saying that because, you know, we never wanted to build our own constellation. We only did that because there were no other options available at that very moment. With that being said, looking forward to the future, because I think that the pandemic has done one thing in a positive manner as well. What has happened over time is that we see that any kind of automation processes, something that is our core business, is actually leapfrogged by at least 5 years when it comes to the fourth industrial revolution. So therefore, we see that at first it was just innovation managers or OEMs talking to us and sharing their thoughts on, okay, maybe one day we want to be connected to 100%. And nowadays it's on the top of every board level where they have to make decisions as they work from home to remotely monitor their assets. So we have all of these kinds of applications now live in the field that we're very proud of and continue to grow our company. So you can reach me on this email. I'm very much open to questions as well. Please let me know if there are any. First from the audience here, and then maybe via Zoom as well, if you don't mind.
Yeah, we only have a couple of minutes here before we got to move on, Coen. Let me just ask you one quickly.
Sure.
So what's the calendar look like for you now? You're talking about a commercial service already for those who can wait with just the two satellites you've got in orbit. What do you look at as the optimal size of your constellation for the businesses you're looking at? And what's the schedule for putting that up into orbit?
Yeah, so we have our Hiber 3 and Hiber 4 satellites ready to be launched. They will go up in December and February, March next year. Those launches are booked and ready to go. Of course, we have basically launch contracts with all the small launch vehicles as well, but they have not really proven mature enough, so to say, as you have seen with Astra, unfortunately, going up in recent days. Yeah. Nonetheless, after that, what we really try to do is make sure we have enough satellites in space to provide a service to our customers. So we're not looking at this from a technical perspective, where we say maybe we need 14 to 16 different satellites in space to actually reach an hourly service, something that we define as the largest market for us. But we really go, you know, as our customers grow, we will make sure that there is enough supply in space, which we can easily handle with our lead times. So we will basically have Hiber 3 and 4 in orbit in Q1, and then we continue to build out a constellation, but that is really on the speed of our customers and not so much on the technical requirements there.
Okay, so the market is okay. You can start certainly something off with the two. You'll have two more and by mid-2021 operational, then that's enough business for you that you grow only then as demand manifests itself, correct?
Yeah, so we are not stuck to a constellation of 48 satellites, for example, or the 16 I just mentioned. Right. We will continue to grow, and those plans are there, but we never look at it from a technical perspective.
Okay, understood. All right, Coen, I'm going to have to leave you there. I appreciate your time.
Perfect.
And good luck to Hiber.
Thank you so much.